Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulullah. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. How's everyone doing? Yeah, a little cold, but alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah for the warmth and alhamdulillah for the cold. My name is Edward Ahmed Mitchell. I'm an attorney and I'm the executive director of CARE Georgia, which is the Georgia chapter of the Council on American Islamic Relations. I want to start by thanking Al-Faruq Masjid for hosting this town hall and self-defense seminar, and I want to thank all of you for coming, and those of you who may watch later at home, thank you for tuning in as well. This is a two-part event. The first part will be the town hall discussion of the election results, the issues we're facing post-election, and how we can solve those problems, how we can stay involved in our community, inshallah. The second part is how we can defend ourselves, our mosques, our persons, our families in the community. So it'll be a two-part event. The first part is very town hall oriented, so we're going to have a panel discussion, but also we want to get questions from you, let you vent a little bit, and so feel free to pipe up and think of things that you want to discuss, inshallah. Our host and moderator will be Aisha Yaqoob, who is a good friend of mine and the executive director of the Georgia Muslim Voter Project, which did so much work leading up to the 2016 election, registering people to vote, encouraging people to vote. They registered over 1,000 new Georgia Muslim voters in this election. And if you notice, in counties around Atlanta, they actually had an unexpected result. Some counties ended up going for candidates that you did not expect them to go for. And I think that's in large part because new voters were registered by Aisha's group and other groups. So I'm very happy that she's here to lead the discussion, and may Allah reward her for all the work that she's done for us, and keep her preserved and successful for all of us, inshallah. Aisha, come on. And we'll begin, of course, by praying that Allah guides all of our words aright, guides our tongues aright, and protects us from saying anything we don't need to say, and may Allah make this event successful and beneficial to all of us, and may Allah grant us success in this life, success in this country, and success in the next, and protect us from the torments thereafter. Ameen.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you, Edward, for that introduction. So, as a lot of you know, after the election, it's been almost two weeks now, our community was shaken. We really weren't sure where to go after the election of a president that had been vilifying our communities. And so this event is really for you to talk about some of the fears you have for yourself, for your family, for your community. And we've got expert guests up here to help address some of those concerns. I want to introduce them briefly, but then also give them a chance to talk about themselves and what perspective they bring to the table. So I'll start at the end with Brother Faraz. He will be representing the ISB today. And then Sister Samira is a community activist and has some experience working in DC, so I'll let her talk about that. And then, of course, you know, Brother Edward from CARE. And we are expecting one more panelist who I'll introduce when he gets here, inshallah. So Brother Faraz.
Assalamu alaikum. So, yeah, so my name is Faraz Iqbal. I'm with the Islamic Speakers Bureau. Born and raised in New Jersey, moved here about, actually it's going to be 10 years in February, believe it or not. So just wanted to kind of talk about what the ISB does. So, you know, some of the things that we've been doing, the programs that we have, is really geared towards outreach, enabling people of the same faith and other faiths to kind of learn more about Islam. So we have programs in schools where we go over Islam 101 in terms of telling people what Islam is about. We have programs in hospitals and clinics, as well as interfaith dialogue with churches, synagogues, and temples and whatnot and the like. So we're, you know, alhamdulillah, a very good broad outreach program within the Atlanta community. Sister Sumaya Khalifa is the lead and is the founder, and she has a lot of, mashallah, good contacts within Atlanta and also outside of Atlanta and D.C. as well, too. One of the programs that we've actually started probably a little bit over a year ago, we piloted it, is called Straight Talk. It's a new program that is really geared towards Islamophobia and identity. It's geared towards the youth, middle school, high school, and college bound. And so we've been doing that program two-part. The first part, we do it with the youth, where we kind of go over some key concepts on how to become a positive influencer. We survey the students as well, too, or the youth. And then after that, we actually have a separate workshop with the parents. to kind of go over what was discussed. And everything is anonymous. We don't say your kid said this, so on and so forth. So everything is anonymous. And we share the survey results with the parents. And then we also do role-playing with the parents as well, too. So we kind of go over, we take a crowd parenting approach on how to work through certain issues. So this past year, especially the last 6 months, we've seen a spike in bullying, especially around Islamophobia. And we can talk more about it. I don't want to eat up all the time. If you guys have questions, I'll answer it. But we have seen a significant spike, and it could be correlated to the campaign in terms of what was being done. And so we've been modifying, tweaking the program. We've had a lot of requests for the program as well, too, in the Atlanta community. We've run it through half a dozen masjids here so far. Approximately 300 to 400 youth have gone through the program. So, you know, something that we're focused on, and hopefully it'll help the community.
We're just introducing ourselves. Okay, assalamu alaikum. I'm Samira Fazli. I moved to Atlanta about a year and a half ago, but when I was in D.C., I was a political appointee in the Obama administration, and I was a senior economic policy advisor both at the Treasury Department and at the White House. So I'm very happy to be able to speak to questions about how DC operates, how the executive branch operates, how Congress and the executive branch interact with each other, ways I experience the influence of constituents through the Hill, et cetera. So I look forward to the discussion.
Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum again. So obviously CARE is America's largest Muslim civil rights organization. What the NAACP does for African Americans, what the Anti-Defamation League does for Jewish Americans, CARE does for American Muslims. Here in Georgia, CARE has been around for years, but it had been volunteer-based most of that time. Had a board of directors, an executive director, but everyone had a day job. In light of the rise of extremist attacks and anti-Muslim bigotry, CARE and other Muslims in the community decided that they needed to establish a full-time office in Georgia dedicated to protecting Georgia Muslims from discrimination. So I was contacted and asked to take that position. My initial reaction was pretty much no. But after praying about it, thinking about it, talking to my family, alhamdulillah, I decided to resign my position as prosecutor and join CARE. And so over the past year, what we've really tried to do is to, make sure that we are addressing those complaints of discrimination that do occur, at the same time that we're building coalitions with other nonprofit organizations in the area, and also engaging in interfaith dialogue, because I think the work that the ISB does and that mosques do as well is so important. Education is the best vaccine for discrimination. If you can educate people about what Muslims really believe and really do, then that on the front end can prevent the problem on the back end of discrimination. So it's really a three-pronged approach we've been pursuing, fighting those cases of discrimination that do arise, whether it's a small thing like someone being harassed in the street, employment discrimination, Newton County Mosque, the veil ban that came up this past week, whether that is building coalitions with the NAACP, the ACLU, or whether that is going to a mosque or going to a church or a synagogue or the Tea Party to deliver a presentation about Islam. So that's what CARE does, and in the next year we hope to start actually hiring additional staff and building a full-time office that goes beyond just me and volunteers. We want to actually fundraise enough to hire staff and really have a full-time dedicated office to defend Muslims from what might come over the next 4 years, inshallah.
Thank you all. I just have a general question for all of our panelists right now. What is one reaction that you've heard a lot from our community after the election, and how have you been talking to people about it? I have my own way of addressing fears and addressing concerns, but it's interesting to see from your perspective, how do you talk to your family and your friends about the future of our country? And I can start with anyone.
And Aisha, if I may, we had a fourth speaker who we were expecting to come, but it looks like they didn't make it. So if I can, I'm going to kidnap someone from the audience who's here. Can I have Imam Suleiman Hamid come up and join us? And just as I said it, our other panelists came, so we'll have a full house. Come on up. Imam Mansour, come on up.
Kidnap, escape.
Yes. Welcome. And we got one more chair. Allah is the best of players. Okay, who wants to take that question first?
Oh, sure, I'll take it. So what I have been spending a lot of time talking to people about is actually how engaging, two forms of engagement that I found had influence in DC. And the first is calling your representatives in Congress, whether it's your senator or your congressman, is very meaningful and it has real effects, even if your senator is the same party as the president. So, you know, we sit here in Georgia and we have two Republican senators, and I think a lot of us have questions over whether they're gonna represent our views and take votes on our behalf. The reality is they do represent you, and you have to make your voice heard by calling their offices and filing complaints about things you're concerned about things that are happening to you, and that's why they have staff. You should be calling their DC offices about whatever is troubling you, or making a commitment to once a week make sure you're calling them. And remember that you will probably have a long-term relationship with their staff, hopefully. So you're very polite and you are remembering to thank them profusely. And it's not like showing that you're angry and being really belligerent and upset is what's going to be effective. Just calling them and saying very matter-of-fact in like a 30-second phone call is enough. The second thing that is very effective is visiting them in their local offices and going to their local events or hosting local events that they are asked to come speak at, because when they are not in session in DC, they come down here to sit with their constituents and hear what's going on. I saw time and time again Democrats stand up against what President Obama was saying because their constituents told them it mattered to them. Like, for example, one place I saw it very effective actually is the appointments process, which we're hearing a lot of discussion right now, people upset about who's being nominated for things like Attorney General or Secretary of State. And people would call their senators, and the senators are the ones who at the end of the day make the decision of who is going to be at a cabinet level, an assistant secretary level, an undersecretarial level. Those are the positions in the agencies that will form and implement all the policies in a new administration. They cannot take their position unless a majority, a supermajority of senators vote them in. So you can call your representative and tell them you oppose those nominations and ask them to oppose it. And time again, Democrats even opposed Obama's nominees at Treasury, like when my experience at the Treasury Department. They were pushing them to get more and more progressive people in there, and they succeeded. So that's one thing I would say: your engagement matters with your representative. Actually, if I can add one more, the second form of engagement that surprised me mattered when I was in government was people protesting publicly and coming out in the streets in a sustained way to hold marches or rallies or vigils. Because if enough people are doing that around the country, that is a way to communicate with your elected representatives. They know they only have so much space to maneuver and to act, because they actually get very scared and frightened by people being out there in the public saying things. And my example there is Occupy Wall Street. So I was at the Treasury Department when the Occupy Wall Street movement happened. It changed the discourse inside the Obama administration. It led people who were much more on the progressive side of economics to gain more power and leverage, and when they were trying to make arguments for policies they wanted to put forth. So there are ways in which even being out there to protest publicly in ways can influence what happens in Washington.
Can we, let everyone run through and then we'll take questions.
Michelle, that's a very nice mic, you know. It's got a good balance to it. I get questions, what's next? What do we do? Especially with a lot of the youth. I got a question the other day saying, hey, you know, I wasn't able to, you know, we're not involved in the voting process, and now we're you know, someone got elected that's going to impact our childhood or our youth, that we're growing up, we had no impact on it. And now we have to reap the repercussions of this person getting elected. Now, you know, the reality of it is that, look, I tell people, take a deep breath, pause. Your neighbors are the same, people around you are the same. So the world has not ended. You know, we need to kind of take a pause on that. You're still going to work, you're still going to school. Now, there's complexities now that have been added. But one of the things is, you know, when talking to youth, students, and to parents is, listen, you need to get out. You know, national organizations that are doing great jobs and are going to continue to do that. But as individuals, you need to get out. Follow the example of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his seerah. He won hearts face to face, one heart at a time. And we have to be willing to do that. Go out and know your neighbors. Do your neighbors know who you are? Do they know you're human beings, that you have families, that you have kids, that you earn, that you pay taxes? That makes a big difference. You know, I tell kids, listen, you know, continue to play with your friends. It's all right, you know. Stand up for yourself. And if you hear something, go to your parents. But, you know, and I tell parents, how many of you in your neighborhood people know who you are? Or are we in our bubble, you know, like our Muslim bubbles, that we hang out with people that we know of the same faith? This is really key. You know, I echo everything that the sister said here, so I don't want to be repetitive in any way, but going out there, talking to people, and you're going to have to get uncomfortable. You're going to have to step out of that comfort zone and talk to people. Start in your neighborhood. Start at your PTA. You know, there's so many things that go on at school that if the parents just went into the PTAs and had a discussion, you would realize how much life you can make easier for your children. There's a lot that can be done out there, but it all starts from each and every one of us. We have to stop playing the savior game. Who's going to save us? No one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save us, of course. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you look at the seerah of the Prophet was in much more difficult times than we were. Much more difficult times. There is no savior. We gotta save ourselves as a community. We gotta come together. We're gonna network and partner with other organizations and people of other faith. But the reality is we gotta save ourselves. We gotta get out there. We gotta talk to our kids. We have a lot of I'm giving you one question that I got, because you said one question. I could give you 100. Some of you may even fall off the chair. Honestly. I almost did. But I had to stay standing, you know, otherwise it's a little weird. But the reality is that get yourself together. You're the adults. Stand firm in front of your children. Let them know everything is okay. Let them know the world is not ended. Let them know we are a fabric of this country. And get involved individually. That would be my thing to echo.
Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum. In this reality that we are experiencing as Muslim Americans, and I'm saying that like that intentionally, Muslim Americans, my Islam comes before my Americanism. But I'm an American. I'm on my third passport, maybe fourth, that I utilize all the time. But I'm a Muslim and I'm American. So what I want to share with you, that I share with the community that I am leading, utilize your rights as an American. Maybe you know where I'm going with that. The Constitution and all of the amendments that happen to be a part of your Constitution, does everybody know where I'm going with that? Those relate to you just like it relates to anyone else who's an American. Well, should I be more specific? Am I not being specific enough? We're in Georgia. So the amendments, first, second, we'll just stop there. All of those things relate to you, right? And anything else that's in the Constitution. So one of the issues that we have as Muslim Americans is we try and live this dual life. Well, I'm a Muslim and I'm in Darul Kufr and all of the kuffar and yada, yada, yada. And then you get treated like you're not an American, right? But understanding that you're in this country, many of us were born in this country, Allah willed for you to live in this country, utilize the country to the best of your ability. And that includes taking advantage of all of those rights and privileges that come to you as a citizen of this country. That's my advice. And then lastly, I'll speak as the African-American in the room. I don't know if you all noticed that. There's one back there too. We have some experience with these people. You understand? And the advice that we give you, they've been like that before Donald Trump was the president. They would have been like that if Hillary was the president. And they're going to remain like that. That's part of their American reality, right? So what are we to do? Continue to build Muslim America, continue to establish what Allah would have us establish in the model of our Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's what will get you respect. That's what will raise your dignity. And that's what will if a person thinks that I could push you over and they'll try it. But when they see that we're established, you're unified, you're not scared, you're utilizing your constitutional rights, it helps to diminish that. So, inshallah. And no, I just came from a meeting with my brother here on the front row. And many people like to use this analogy. We're here at Masjid Farooq. Atlanta Masjid is the other big masjid in Atlanta. I don't know if you all knew that. But the picture was posed of the Muhajireen and the Ansar. You all with me? A group of people who were new to an environment and people who were indigenous to the environment. We're your Ansar. But you have to embrace your Ansar. Right? Just like the Ansar have to embrace the one who traveled. Now, if you come and then you say, well, I don't want to put my arms around you, sister. I don't want to put... Then how can we stand united and fight anybody else? Right? So let us be together amongst ourselves as Muslims in this country, Muslims in this city, Muslims in this state, and everything's going to be all right. The devil will be the devil all the time, and the righteous people will prosper. That's what Allah says. Shalom.
You sound like thunder.
Aren't you glad we kidnapped and brought up the stage, alhamdulillah? So I want to introduce Imam Mansour Sabri, who is Imam Emeritus of Atlanta Masjid al-Islam and the head of Iman Atlanta. And alhamdulillah is the best of planners, as we can see, as you have a leader of community activism here, civil rights activism, political activism, interfaith dialogue, and religious activism. So alhamdulillah, we have a good balance of people here. So I welcome Imam Mansour to share
his thoughts. Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
I have a terrible cold.
Goodness.
SubhanAllah. So make dua for me for Shifa. I did not want to stay at home. I wanted to be here with the community and share just a little bit about my thoughts as to where we are and what we need to do. So as long as my voice stands, I will speak, which is very short. So Bismillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. The formula that I believe we need to hold high for ourselves and for our children is faith in God, hard work, simple living, and high thinking. Faith in God, hard work, simple living, and high thinking. There's no reason today for us to lose our faith, and there's no reason today for our children to turn away from their faith. The challenges that we're facing are increasing us in iman, whether we like it or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say we will come to Him willingly or unwillingly. And these trying times are allowing for us to strengthen our iman, strengthen our faith. So every test is a test for the believer. It is not enough for us to say that we believe and not be tried and tested. We know this. Our biggest test will be for our women, our wives, our daughters, and our sisters. And because that is the greater test of their appearance as Muslima, as Muslim women, and because of their outward dress in a society that looks at the outward appearance to judge people. So I say that as a black man. That is a reality towards certain appearances that will put you at the front line of the aggression that has already been here, but we should expect to increase. There is a conversation, and I'm still speaking on faith, there's a conversation that every African-American mother and father has with their son before they leave the house. It is a conversation of consciousness of who they are and the world that they're existing in. If you have not begun to formulate that conversation for yourself and for your children, then now, more than ever, is the time to begin to instill those seeds, plant those seeds in their minds about who they are, the confidence that is needed to move through the earth as people of faith, people who believe in Allah and who believe in the last day, but even in addition to that, believe in the goodness of other people. So the heightened fears are here, but our heightened faith will tell us that we should believe that there's a coalition of men, women, and angels that come to the aid of those who have faith.
And we should celebrate that reality that Allah will be with us when we stand with Him. So faith in God, keeping it strong, keeping that conversation real every morning when your children go to school, whether it's in a Muslim setting or a non-Muslim setting, whether it's with all children who look like them or with children of diverse looks. They should have a conversation around their consciousness and plant the right seeds in their minds about where they are. For yourselves, and I know children will help us be more responsible. You'll be less responsible with yourself sometimes. You want to just put your hand under the covers and say, everything's going to be all right. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to change what I've been doing. But the reality is that we do have to have a real conversation with ourselves about our workplace violence. Have a real conversation about our neighborhoods. And have we truly met our neighbors? Do we really know our neighborhood association? Do we know our public officials? Do they know us? Have I made that effort? Or have I been waiting for someone else to make that effort for me? And then responding in that way and engaging. And then depending on the age of your children and even your siblings, then you should be having a family mobilization first. The Inner City Muslim Action Network focuses on urban communities of diverse ethnicities, religions. But the common core is what we all want to strive to make our city, our neighborhoods, how we want them to be. The common core is about envisioning the world that we want to see. And so the Muslim Action Network is not about only being Muslim, but it's about drawing our attention to aligning with others, to making sure that we're respecting the human values of everyone. When we think about what, I'll share this and then I'll close. When we think about some of the more practical things that are happening within our neighborhoods and our city, of what we can do, this is an urgent time for engagement. And that engagement is not on the political level only, but this is engagement of coalitions of people who are working and standing for human rights, standing for the rights of our frontline communities that will be suffering. Last night we had a social justice rally in the southwest side of Atlanta, special guest with Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, and you know his story, you know his work in the community. But a part of the conversation was about alliance building with the Latino community and the African-American community, for those who understand the very great value of that in our country. In alignment with the Muslim community, because there is a lack of alignment between the masajid, between the diversity within our ummah, where there's an intentional alliance building that brings us together. And I want to applaud the work of Edward, of Ahmed, and Sister Yaqoob for really working to bring some of the most diverse groups together that I've seen in the history of Atlantic Muslim community, working together, not just in conversation like today. Powerful and moving and changing really lives in many respects. But the alliance building aspect of coalition building beyond the Muslim community is critical. We have not done enough. There's so much more to do. They have no clue who we are, what we believe in, and what we want. We're clear about it, but we have to be able to really show by our work in the neighborhoods and work in the city of Atlanta, the work in our prospective communities across Georgia, to really show what we stand for in values and principles. Faith in God, hard work, simple living, high thinking.
So I'm just going to try to sum up my thoughts in one answer, because I want Aisha to get to ask more questions and get to the audience. So 12 years ago, I was 18 years old. I turned 18 just in time to vote in the 2004 presidential election. That was the first time I voted, and I was very much into politics at the time. I went to a John Kerry campaign rally, had his signed campaign literature on my wall. In the middle of the day at school, at high school, I'd run to the library to check the computers to see the polls. I was very, very politically active. And so that was my main interest at the time. And I wasn't particularly religious at the time. I'd only taken Shahada in September of 2004. And so really, I put my faith at the time in politicians. You know, I thought politicians would save us and politicians would harm us. And so you can imagine my horror when President Bush was reelected in 2004, much to my surprise. I mean, I
cried, I cursed, I showed up at school the next day in sweatpants and a hoodie, which is very unlike me if you know me, if you're one of my friends. I had a meltdown. I had to go through the 7 stages of grief to get over that. And so when I saw the election results coming in last Tuesday, I'm speaking just as a person now, I started to go through that again, the 7 stages of grief, the shock, and I said, I'm going to bed early. I went to bed at 9:30 once I saw where it was going, because I know politics and I could tell when it was going south before other people did, so I said, I'm going to bed. And I couldn't sleep. Fought my pillow, tossed and turned. It was happening all over again. But there was a difference this time, alhamdulillah. This time I had Islam. And so I was able to remind myself that verily after difficulty comes relief. That verily, you know, Allah tests us with fear, hunger, loss of wealth, but give good news to those who are patient. They are the ones who receive blessings from God. And so alhamdulillah, that night I got out of bed, couldn't go to sleep, made wudu, prayed, fasted the next day, felt a lot better, alhamdulillah. And so what I want to say about, you know, where we go from here, 2 things occur to me. One, you know, you might expect me to talk about the civil rights aspect, but that's not the first thing that occurs to me. The first thing that scared me about the election is not Donald Trump or anyone else, because we have nothing to fear from people, but I feared the possibility that we were about to undergo a serious trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the first thing we all need to worry about, as the Imam said, is the faith part. Because over the past week, we've seen kids getting bullied. I've heard of multiple Muslim women saying, I'm going to take off my hijab because I'm afraid. And I don't think that's the right response. And I don't think it's the right response for kids who get bullied just to say it's part of the business of going to school and not tell anyone. And that's happening as well. So, you know, my greatest fear for Muslims has never been that we'd be deported or interned or registered. My fear for us is that we would win a place in the society, our rightful place, we're already here, but that we would really win full acceptance like Jewish people and Catholics came before us, but that we would lose what makes us Muslim. That a few generations from now we'd be so liberalized and secularized that we would just be nominal cultural Muslims. That is, we'd win the battle and lose the war. And I'm concerned that fear of our neighbors could speed that process up. Make people take off their hijabs, shave their beards, stop talking, saying inshallah, God willing, in public. That was my concern. And so I think that the first thing we all need to do is take the election as an opportunity to check ourselves before we get checked. To think about the things that we do that may displease Allah and make sure we fix those things so that Allah is on our side, because we don't need the president on our side, we need God on our side. And no matter what trials come, as long as Allah is on our side, it's going to be okay, inshallah. So the first thing I say is let's check ourselves. And I gave a buy-in at Juma on Friday, and I got into some specific things that we may not talk about much. You know, some of us, and speaking myself as well, we do things that, you know, are really problematic from an Islamic perspective, and we don't think about it. You know, some of us, we own businesses where we sell things that are haram, alcohol, cigarettes. That's not okay. That can bring difficulty upon all of us. Some of us, we bought our house a long time ago. We bought them with haram mortgages. That's a problem. Maybe we should call up Guidance Residential, get that switched over. Some of us, we have bad tempers. We get angry, shout at our families, we curse. Not okay. We should work on that. Some of us, even though we'll pray side by side with our neighbors of different races, we'll flip out if they try to marry our son or our daughter. It's not okay. We should work on that. So I just say that to say that my first concern was that that whatever's coming from Donald Trump, that I just don't want it to be a punishment on us. So it's not afraid, we don't have to be afraid of Donald Trump. But if you look at history, our Jewish community, Christian community, Muslim community, Allah says that, you know, people have been trials for people who don't believe. That is, that's happened. And so I don't want that to happen. I want this to be a positive trial that works out for the best. And so that was the first thing. The second thing I'll say very quickly is, all right, we work on the faith part. Now what do we do in terms of our actual activities in the dunya to handle this? So the first thing is to support all the organizations sitting here. Iman Atlanta and their community activism is critical. Political activism is critical. He Wesco, leader of the Green Party, is here. He can tell you a lot about advocating with the state legislature. That's critical. Aisha's Georgia Muslim Voter Project. Doesn't have to be a campaign season to register to vote and to get active, right? ISB, interfaith dialogue, is the most important thing we can do. I think it's more important than what I do, because education is the best vaccine for discrimination. And obviously, Atlanta Masjid and the religious activism is critical and the most overarching thing. So support these organizations with your time, with your money, with your dua. Second thing is make sure your kids know that if they are bullied, speak up. You know, the kids are just taking it off, you know, just saying, all right, well, I don't want to say anything because it'll make things worse. I don't think my teachers will do anything about it. Let your parents know. If you don't want to let them know, let the teachers know. If you don't want to let them know, at least let us know. We announced earlier this week a hotline that kids can use, anyone can use, to report discrimination. Speak up at careGA.com. Speak up at CAIRGA.com. If you get harassed, if you are bullied, obviously if it's an emergency, call the cops first, but then speak up at CAIRGA.com. Speak up at careGA.com. We need to collect stats about what's happening, and we need to start planning effectively about how to handle and respond to that, whether that's asking the state school superintendent to do something, which we're doing. We're about to send him a letter signed by multiple organizations. So that's the other thing. Speak up when something happens. The other thing is learn how to defend yourself. The second part of this will be the self-defense seminar, because as Farah said, we don't want to wait for anyone else to save us. We want to be able to help ourselves. So, sisters, if someone comes up to you and tries to grab your hijab, we want them to be in for a rude awakening. So, you know, go through self-defense seminar lessons. Aisha's planning an all-female self-defense class that will involve, you know, actual experiential learning. So do that, inshallah. Learn how to protect yourselves. And what to carry with you in case you need to protect yourselves. Mosque security. A lot of us have mosques. We don't lock the door. We don't have a code. Anyone can come in and out while we're praying and our backs are turned. Not anymore. I think you need to talk. We'll talk about that. But the point is, that's another thing to work on is self-defense. Make sure we're protecting ourselves. There are other things I could say, but I want to get to more questions. So those are my thoughts.
Thank you to all the speakers. One of the things that I didn't hear mentioned here in depth, Imam Mansur touched on it a little bit, but getting to know your local elected officials. So I'm just going to ask for a show of hands. How many of you know the name of your county commissioner? Okay, that's not nearly enough people in this room. I will just let you know from my experience, the work that I do with the Georgia Muslim Voter Project, one of the things that I always tell people is, yes, we just elected a president, but what about the other people that were on your ballot? What about your state legislatures, your state legislative representatives? What about your county commissioner and your city council? A lot of you may not know that your county commission, some counties and most city councils are actually nonpartisan. So if you were to run for office or even engage your elected officials on a local level, it's not really about party affiliation. It's more about what can they do to better serve you. We saw in Newton County, we had issues with the county commission not approving the land use for a masjid, and that was controversial. They couldn't call it a partisan issue, but we saw that, and that's where engaging your local elected officials really comes into play. So, you know, we'll talk a little bit more about steps you can take, but for one of the things that I would like to tell you guys is go to a county commission meeting. Go to your next city council meeting. They're usually the first Tuesday or the third Tuesday or the fourth Tuesday of the month. Look it up online. I know Gwinnett County has meetings all the time, but not just meetings, get involved. A lot of counties have citizen academies. I actually just finished participating in the Gwinnett Citizens Academy, which gave me access to department directors in every single department in the county, including the police department. So I did get to do a ride-along with a Gwinnett County police officer and actually got to see the work that they do and have a conversation about how can they better work to protect our community in Gwinnett County. So definitely look at those opportunities, and if you stay connected with us, I will send out a list of opportunities for you to actually get involved in the coming year, because it is important to know what's going on in the federal government, but they're not going to be the ones affecting your day-to-day life. It's the county commission, the city council, and sometimes even the state legislature that will affect your kid's school, your local city council, and anything that you will see on a day-to-day basis. So that was just something I wanted to add. We will open up for questions now. So I know, Umber, you had a question over here if you want to.
Mobilizing right now, like Schumer and, you know, Bernie Sanders and Keith Ellison, that they will kind of keep things going okay and try to block some of these appointments. How much, like, how much faith do you have?
So I'll repeat that for anyone that didn't hear. She was just asking, how much faith do you have in the Democratic Party and people in the party that they will block some of these things that are coming up in the next congressional cycle?
I feel like we're not getting a lot of news about. We're having to dig to find out what all of them are doing.
Yeah. Well, one, I mean, you are always going to have to dig for news because the media is going to cover what the media cares about. So you will have to take it upon yourself to, like, call them up and ask, did you take a public position on this or that? There are I think like 132 Congress people who came out against Steve Bannon already this week. Steve Bannon's appointment, who, for those who don't know, is like a was appointed to be a senior advisor at the White House, in the Trump White House, and a lot of people have concerns that he has strong links to white supremacist or alt-right groups. So I think that at the end of the day, if they hear from people, they take positions. And if they hear from enough people, they take positions. I'm not saying put blind faith in elected officials. I'm saying it's on all of us, the way that the system here operates. You have to get engaged, because they're not going to take positions on your behalf if you're not calling them and telling them why it matters to you and that you're a constituent who votes or who, you know, donates to their party. And to reinforce some other things that we're talking about before, this is also why it's very important that we do the interfaith work and we do the coalition building work at the local level, because there are always only going to be so many Muslims everywhere. And you need to have friends in the Latino community, in the Jewish community, in all communities who say, we stand with you guys. And they will not do that unless they have met Muslims who tell them this stuff matters to us. And if we have not come out and protested what's happening to, say, undocumented immigrants or the children who were brought here too young to know that they were illegal immigrants. So there's going to be a lot of things we're going to be asked to do to help participate and support other groups as well, so that they'll support us. But I did see, I mean, it's a very non-linear process out there. So like, just because you call and it doesn't work the first time doesn't mean on the fourth issue it's going to work. And the other thing that Aisha had brought up on engaging at the local level, our system here is highly, highly decentralized. Local governments, governors and mayors especially, can take positions in a lot of areas that are opposite what the federal government is doing, and they have enough power to do that. So immigration's a great example there. There are a lot of cities that have said they will not enforce immigration rules that come down to deport people that happened in the Bush administration years too. It was called sanctuary cities. So there are a lot of ways, if you engage at the local and state level, you can see more protective rights being given to your community at the state and local level. Civil rights is another area. A lot of states have higher civil rights protections than the federal government.
We have a question over here.
Assalamu alaikum. Yes, my name is Bilal Mahmoud. I'm executive director for OPOW, which is a voice for the voiceless. One of the things that our sister touched upon is that media coverage, ABC, NBC, CBS, Chicken Noodle Network, we can't wait for them to carry our narrative. We have to be the ones to carry our narrative. The other thing is, with your propaganda machinery, it's very important that you establish alliances. 2 weeks ago, I was in Standing Rock. I'm not in India, but Standing Rock is a hot issue in America today. Black Lives Matter. I haven't seen that many Muslims involved in Black Lives Matter, except those that look like me. So again, if we don't align ourselves with people in their causes, when the door of our houses get marked with the X, they're going to ignore it. So we invite every one of you to become a member of OPOW. You can Google my name, Bilal Mahmoud, B-I-L-A-L-M-A-H-M-U-D. There's no cost, okay? And we're hitting 57 countries around the world. And we're not afraid to put the truth out there.
Can I add something, Sister Aisha? And Brother Bilal is one of my mentors, so he won't mind me adding this. But use caution. And I'm going to put this with what Brother Edward said. In building your alliances, make sure that the cause of that alliance is not against Islam.
Okay. Yeah.
And I'll just leave it at that. That's not an alliance that you need. You'll actually do more harm to yourself by showing that you don't have any standards when you will lift up some, and most of the time, and I'm going to speak as the African-American in the room again, the way that the primary cause that has been passed in this country, it was on the backs of black people. And that's something, as religious people, that we don't stand for. So just use caution with that. But he knows me, and he comes and mentors me twice a week. So he knows that this is not anything directed towards his comment. Just use caution with that, child.
Sister in the back was raising her hand as well.
Just a reminder, we're going to try to keep your question and comments about 30 seconds so we can make sure we get to as many people as possible before we do the self-defense
question. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All of you have very good and very poignant positions that you have taken. But the reality is part of what is on a day-to-day basis as well. The Muslims who need things have to go to the Christians. We, as the religion, have the forthright through our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stand before the community and be one of outreach to not only the other Muslims, but also to the non-Muslim community. The people who are fearful are fearing that they who are white or who are non-Muslim are fearing that whatever little material things that they have or whatever that they may have gained in one time or losing, they're losing it to those, quote, immigrants. So we need to do a coalition on another level as well. That level is a social service that provides charitable activities not only to other Muslims but also to the non-Islamic community in an outright format that is very visible. Once you see that people will reach across the board to you because of their needs, they will break down some of their hostility because you are the one that are helping them and not another Christian or another Jew that they have to go to. And we are missing in action in that aspect. So we need to Atlanta Masjid, Al-Farouk, and a lot of other major masjids around us come together as a coalition, social service coalition, where all Muslims that are out there and without housing, without whatever, can come together and get some assistance from the Muslim community and let that door open for the non-Muslim community as well, inshallah. So we don't, as Muslims, don't have to go to the Christians.
Really helpful where some gaps are here in the local school,
food, space? Food, shelter. There are Muslim women who are going to non-Muslim shelters, taking off their hijab, because the men here in four county areas, 99% of all the services are directed toward the men, and they blend in Muslim and non-Muslims. But the women, there's nothing out there for them except three places, and one of them is under investigation, and one of them I'm speaking outright against on public television in front of city council because of their illegal activities. So I can assure you, we don't have a place for transition for women, and if you're a Muslim woman, they try to blend in as a Christian now. That's a shameful position to have to be in. And if you're without food, there's nobody that just feeding somebody every 2 weeks on a Sunday ain't gonna work. If you think that you had to take money and your food from a Muslim to give it to a Christian, ain't going to work. So there needs to be a day-to-day process where the Muslims can come, whether it's mental health, coalition, whatever. I've got a proposal that I can give to all of you to show you how the foundation works. And when we talk about having our own money, it's so easy to do an Islamic credit union. It's not funny. It takes $30 from 300 people. And the process is easy to get processed. And we don't have to do riba, another hateful thing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So charity is one of our pillars, and so is not dealing with this riba issues. So social services is the things that we need to be on the forefront, and then political issues may break down by themselves.
Thank you, sister.
I'm not certain I wanted to mention something available.
What the sister is saying is extremely important. So I would be doing failing if I did mention this. Enough to share food pantry. That's Mondays and Wednesdays from 2 to 4 at Atlanta Masjid. Absolutely free for Muslims and non-Muslims. We're actually, unfortunately, I don't like it. We're actually serving more non-Muslims than we are Muslims. Muslims sometimes have an ego trip to come ask the Muslims. So that's one. Also Masjid Mu'minun has a food pantry. I don't know their hours. Maybe someone does. And then we would all be doing ourselves a disservice if we didn't mention Share Atlanta, which does some very good work. I don't know if Beit Salam is still functional as relates to the home. I know there's one. There is a house that provides housing for the sisters. So I would suggest that you get with Brother Bilal Mahmoud. He may be able to direct you to that in particular. But what she's saying, I accept that we are, as leadership, are failing. And because of that, those things have been established. I want to make sure that the sister knows about that and anybody else that can take. I want more Muslims to benefit from the food pantry that the Atlanta Masjid has because of what she's saying. So I encourage us to come and, you know, and hey, sometimes you might just not have enough groceries at home. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're homeless or something like that. Benefit. I tell the people that's an obligation for us to give that. So we invite people to benefit from that, shall we?
Maybe have each masjid, at least one masjid per week, do something the way the Christians do it, then maybe there might be a good reason to know. But I'm familiar with all of those sources in the community and those that I tell people to stay away from.
Jazakallah. We need to get to a few more questions.
Yes, Dr. Khalid up here had a question as well.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We're going through some different difficult times, and this is nothing new in the history of Islam or mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us, وَلَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ, that we shall be sure we shall try or test you with something of fear, hunger, etc., etc. But when we go through a situation like this, we should assume khair rather than shur. The assumption should be of goodness. This. And we are so pleased at Al Farooq Masjid. We have received many, many, many letters on our website with, of support. What can I do? I've not come to your mosque, but how can I help? Church groups have sent, the pastors have sent letters. So there is a lot of goodwill that, and we need to tap into that goodwill. So assuming doom and gloom is really not the way that we Muslims should be. Now, this also provides an opportunity. Remember, any catastrophic event that affects the Muslims increases the conversion rate to Islam. It draws attention of the masses towards Islam. It increases the conversion rate. And this would be an opportunity for us at this time, inshallah, to show the best of Islam in our personal conduct, in our community life, in our groups, in our homes, in our schools, in our neighborhoods. So, as was mentioned earlier, get out and get involved. Get involved in the PTA. Go visit just your neighbor or something like that. And the final point that I would make is that there is a very beautiful verse in the Quran al-Kareem, which says that repel what is evil with good. Repel what is evil with good. وَلَا تَسْتَفِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيَّةُ اِدْفَى بِالَّذِي أَحْسَنُ. That is, nor can goodness and evil be equal. Repel evil with what is better. Then he between whom and you was hatred become as if he were your friend and intimate. I think the lessons in the Quran are so staring at us. We just have to open the book and read it. And have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think my brothers have said a lot. But have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a time to hide under the bed. It's not a time to keep your kids away from school and go to homeschooling, etc., etc. We'll just be confining ourselves more and more and more. This is the time to show that we are part of America, that we are a society that contributes nothing but good to the society that we live in. Muslim communities are communities that bring peace and security. They are the most crime-free communities, they are the most drug-free communities, they are the most prostitution-free communities, they are the most gang-free communities in America. And we have to project that aspect of our life and make others, those who are uneducated about Islam, number one, be aware of what Islamic teachings are, and second, that we are assets to the societies that we live in rather than liabilities, inshallah.
Would any of our panelists like to add anything to that point?
Thank you, Dr. Collin. That was a very important reminder. You know, I wanted to just add this because We have to understand this is a conversation amongst Muslims, and we are a very diverse group of people. But the country we live in is having an ideology war about those who believe this country should be inclusive and those who believe this country should be exclusive. So I want to make two points. That when we move forward, when I'm speaking about coalition building and building alliances, the first thing we have to do is just show up. And that's not like a metaphor for something bigger than just showing up. That when we're called upon as minority communities who are on the front line of the bigotry that will take place from time to time in our era, and this is calling consciousness to our tests, but we're pulling from our history and our ancestry and pulling from the legacy of Islam over time to know that this time will pass as well. But this is our first test in many cases. This is our first experience with hatred in many cases. And you may not know how to deal with it even with all the knowledge and reading you may do. But that simple response and that simple thing that we must do is show up. Stand up. One of the activities that's coming up very soon is going to be the inauguration of Donald Trump. What's his middle initial?
J.
J. Donald J. Trump. And some of us still don't even want to say his name. So there's still some of those steps in the process.
He who shall not be named.
This is a recovery process, hasn't gotten to that point yet. Seven stages. So we got to get there very quickly, because we're a part of the process is that we're going to have to stand for what we believe in a coalition with others who believe in the same thing, that this is the wrong guy to be president of the United States. And it's not even about him, the name, but the ideology that comes with him and the people who think that they're taking back the vision of this country. And so you have to believe in something for America, and you got to stand for what you believe in for this country and this land. So that day is coming, but there's also a day that is on the National Celebration Day, and that is Martin Luther King Day, which is right before it. And it is my intention to work with a coalition of activists, leaders within Atlanta, to mobilize one of the largest groups of folks to say that our country is what we define it to be, and it would not be redefined for us. And that stands, and that representation of Muslims, Jews, Christians, Latinos, African Americans, not just us, mobilizing and coming together with a united voice will be unique for our city to make sure that our home gets a bigger message than what nationally may be projected and portrayed through media. But they'll get a message from us right here at home. So I'm putting that out there now because it's a very short time to organize and prepare it, but to keep that on your mind that when a call is made for you to stand with your brothers and sisters of humanity for a vision of this country that we believe in as Muslims, then we have to show up, inshallah.
So one quick comment. Am I allowed to sign homework? This is the Sunday school teacher part coming out, right? So. You know, there's the Quran has, you know, so many answers, and this is one, you know, story. If you look at study the seerah of the Prophet, it's awesome. You know, the Sahabas used to greet each other. You know, they used to do a handshake when they used to meet each other, and they used to recite a certain surah as a reminder of the covenant as a Muslim, which you're supposed to do. Does anyone know what that surah is? Well, that's it. Read Surah Asr. Well, Asr. There are four things in there it tells us to do. It says, man is at a loss. Not women as well. Man is, you know, so just... We
humankind.
Humankind. I don't want people to think, oh, men only. But mankind is at a loss. With the exception, if you do four things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the answers if we choose to take it to heed. Four things. First is, have faith. Everything we talked about here, we talked about having faith. The second thing is, act on that faith. It's one thing to have faith, but then say, oh, subhanAllah, bismillah, and do nothing on it. Act on the faith, which we could summarize that that's part of it too. The third one is, bring people to good, counsel people on being good.
Again, if we talk about everything we've talked about, you're counseling people on being good. And the fourth thing, be steadfast. Be patient. My brothers and sisters, these things is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. When we're looking for an answer, we could talk to the wild, you know, the wisest people on earth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, gave this, and the sahabas and the prophet used to shake hands on this every time. You know how they used to shake hands? They used to grab each other like this. Right? Actually, in the earlier areas too. Well, we got this. Right? Like this. This is how they grabbed hands and they shook and they recited that surah. As a reminder to each other that, listen, this is what Islam is about. This is what we need to do. So when we talk about talking with our kids, getting involved, making sure that we're saying the right things, make sure that we take these four things into consideration. Because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us. It's a, I as homework assignment, do the tafsir, read the tafsir of this short surah. Read the background of this surah, when it was revealed, and what was going on at the time. And another homework assignment, one more homework assignment. All of you today, in your neighborhoods, reach out to someone of another faith in your neighborhood that you have not reached out to so far. Whether you live there for 1 year or 30 years. Reach out, talk to them, say, hi, my name is such and such. Don't make it a religious thing. I am a Muslim and this, no. Reach out and say, this is my name, this is my family. Maybe you'll invite them for a cup of tea and a coffee or whatever you drink. Because Islam is all about action, it's not about words. When someone sees you, how they act, when it's time for prayer, you break for prayer, you have certain etiquettes, that's what they're going to believe in. Not the lip service. That's the only 2 cents I have. Thanks.
Yeah, there's a brother in the back that has had his hand raised for a while. Do you need the mic?
Pretty loud. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Khaled. I do a lot of work with the Khloxi community and a lot of just organizing around in different areas. One thing that I've noticed is that a lot of times when there's prompts to do actions, a lot of times when we talk to our people, we talk to our people in a place of like volunteerism. Hey, can you come out and help these people? Hey, can you sign this one petition? Hey, can you do this one action? But we're in a time where we actually need to build and do things to both defend our community, to build up our institutions, to do more. How do we move people from the sense of volunteerism, where we're like, okay, just sign this petition, please, can you just do this one thing, to moving them to be, hey, you are a leader in our community. How do we transition people into that sort of place where they can think that they can do the change that we're talking about? Because they can do this one action. We've seen our people do actions and do these sort of things, but how do we get them to be leaders now?
Great question. Imam Mansour has something to say.
Question. And he's speaking like an organizer. So that's okay. And inshallah, I want to definitely speak with you afterwards.
He is, by the way.
No doubt. No doubt. So I think he raises a very important point. And a very direct answer to that is that organizers receive training. And if you want to become a doctor, then you have to get proper training. If you want to become an engineer or mechanic, then you have to be trained by an engineer or mechanic. This type of mobilizing and taking it to the next step beyond just engaging folks in an action, and it's always going to be, we look for the quality of self-interest, meaning that people are directly engaged and involved in that because of self-interest. We get a lot of self-interest in this room that is aligned. And so the idea is that we have to begin to have community organizing training that allows for folks to have the tools and the knowledge to take that next step. We've done community organizing training this year. We're planning to do 4 more sessions, Inner City Muslim Action Network, for the coming new year. The first will be in January. I will make that public and allow for everyone to know what that is and what that means. But it is about really coming to understand the long history of tools that have been used to organize our communities, mobilize our communities, and keep them actively engaged with leaders. I know everyone on this panel, and that is a blessing, but at a certain point we should be getting to know new leaders and getting to know new activists and getting excited about the growth of the idea of having individuals in key and core areas of leadership, inshallah.
One thing I would say is that I had the pleasure a few weekends ago of being at a youth camp with Muslim youth, and Imad was there, and one of the things that CARE did there was a public speaking training for youth. because so many young people spend so much time on their phones or typing, they can't form a coherent sentence. You ask them to defend Islam, you got a problem. So organizing is key, but also being able to speak in public and effectively, no matter what your career is important. So, you know, CARE, we go into mosques that invite us, we do know your rights presentations, well, you know, what to do when you're acting with law enforcement, know your rights if you're at the airport, know your rights as an employee. We do Islamic last will and testament seminars, but what I want to start doing more often is the public speaking training for youth. So invite me to your mosque, inshallah. The services are free. We'll come and do a public speaking for youth training because that's important as well, inshallah.
And I hope that it's events like this. It's like holding lots of different events, whether it's direct training or awareness building sessions that help people realize there are a continuum of ways for you, everyone, to get involved. You can start off by talking to your neighbor, and then you can start off by worrying about your kids bullying and talking to the PTA and the principals. And through acts of volunteerism, you start to realize it can build into a lot more. It can build into building power, which is another thing the community organizers like to talk about. And it motivates you to want to develop yourself and your own skills to keep engaging and becoming a leader, whether by going to a citizens academy like Aisha went to, right? Or going to the community organizer training. There are lots of opportunities for you, or public speaking training, lots of opportunities for everyone, and everyone should be building themselves in their own capacity to engage in the ways that they want to engage. And I also want to commend the brother for reminding us all that we're not followers. Everyone here in this room is a leader in their own right, and so you can be taking actions of any kind. So
I feel kind of responsible for one additional point, separate from what has been said, and I think we've been very encouraging as people of faith. But there's a man that I met who did 35 years in prison for a crime he didn't commit. And I asked him, what kept you, a beautiful spirit. I mean, you would never know if you met him. If he was in this room, you wouldn't know. If he was a person you met every day, you wouldn't know. He just has a wonderful spirit of Islam. So what kept you alive inside through all that time? He said, Surah to Yusuf. So the faith is real. The faith is real amongst believers that can keep you and take you through hell on earth. That's real. I want to give that example. But then on the other side of that, said you're going to be confronted with situations. La samahallah, may Allah never permit it to happen. You're going to be in a situation where your neighbor is the devil himself. Your coworker will give you a life of hell, and you have to make a real choice to leave that situation. Your child is in a school that has more bullies than he can deal with on a day-to-day basis to keep his sanity, and you have to make a choice that homeschool may be better for this time period. So, or taking him to an Islamic school or a private school, right? A better environment, changing environment. You may have to move. But I'm saying that be empowered through your faith to make the right choices in the moment and not to suffer unnecessarily, but be aligned with people who will support you. Find the right environment for you to thrive. Find the right environment so that you will have the right support. Because there is that incident that will happen that we will talk about and hear about and share. And I don't like to bring out the statistics in the previous stories, but sometimes we have short memories and we forget about North Carolina. You know, we forget about Newtown. We forget about these places across the country that good, innocent people were faced with choices that they may have could have done something different if they were given the advice to say, move forward, move out, get the right type of advice for dealing with these terrible situations that happen in our country. So I want to just share that and include that in this conversation as a town hall, that you may be in a position where you must make a direct action for yourself and get out of that situation.
We do have to get moving to the self-defense portion of the class, and I do urge you to come chat with the panelists afterwards. I'm going to just close up and ask each of the panelists, I know Brother Faraz touched on this already with some homework, what is one action item that you would give to our audience before, and then we'll move on to the self-defense workshop, and you can chat with the panelists afterwards.
I want to say something. A town hall meeting is way more important than other issues or events that we have in the city. For us to have an hour and a half to discuss something that's extremely, extremely important, that is sad. It's So I go by and direct by saying we should see more of those all over the city. And for us to be given 30 minutes to ask questions, I just believe that this is an urgent matter. For those who know me, I like to do things instead of talking. And I'm really, truly had to say the following couple of things. I don't mean to disrupt the, but it seems that we need to do interfaith.
As opposed for us to do interfaith.
It seems that we don't know each other.
It is sad for me to know that whenever there is an event at a local masjid, few Muslims from other parts of the city would show up. Actually, in another event, more Muslims showed up at an event, at an interfaith event, than that event at a masjid. We have a problem. North of the city, we're totally, totally isolated from the brothers south of the city. So we're being asked to reach out to the African American, to the Latino Muslims or whatever, but we need to reach out to each other. That's one thing. The second thing that really bothers me, and that's what I said, he's told my story. The second thing, we need to be picky about those that we do interfaith with them. As a business transaction, if I'm reaching out to you once and twice and three and four and five, and whenever there is a need for me to see you standing next to me, I'm doing a bad job choosing those that I do interfaith with them. And I'll give a clear example. About 6 months ago, I led the initiative of having that AGC ad, you know, Muslims. I wanted to do it the other way around. I was looking for those that we've done interfaith with them for the past 20 years to come and stand, say, we stand with Muslims. Those do not represent the Muslim that we know. And I have some news for you. Two organizations stood with us. Two organizations. That means we have done a bad job in the past 20 years reaching out to those that we think will be there for us. In New York, they had a big ad in New York Times or whatever one of those made. It was all non-Muslims saying, we're standing with Muslims in this occasion. So again, I just believe that we need to get to know each other. JazakAllah khair.
If you have a question or a comment that you can make in 30 seconds and you really want to make it, raise your hand. Oh, just one person? Two people? Okay. So we're in a bit of a rush because one of our security panelists had to go, but he's given us the green light to go a little longer. So let's get just a few more comments or questions in, and then we'll wrap up, inshallah. Yeah. Can we go to a sister?
Yeah.
We'll go to a sister and then come back to you.
I'll try to keep it to 30 seconds. JazakAllah khair for the wonderful comments on activism. My name is Zahra, and I'm part of Muslim Wellness Foundation Atlanta. We work to promote mental health awareness in the Muslim community, and I think mental health is very connected to everything all of you are talking about, and I would just really emphasize in this time, we are going through a lot of challenges, and we need to keep the message of hope and resilience alive, but also making it okay to not be okay and to share all of our feelings is actually a really important component of activism. Whether you are a parent, whether you are a friend, a Sunday school teacher, letting children and ourselves know that it's okay to acknowledge that we're scared or sad or hopeful, all of the feelings are important to be recognized before we take action. And even if you are an activist, make sure that you and I, all of us, maintain self-care strategies, whether it's reaching out to our family, whether it's talking to an imam or a counselor, making sure you nourish yourself before you give to others, because you don't want that light to go out before you share with others. And I'm reminded of the Prophet ﷺ, where he reached out to Khadija radiallahu anha when he first received the revelation. He needed to do that and to surround himself with that support before he could create the community of believers. So if any of you would like to speak to me or to other people involved with mental health after this event, please feel free to do so. And please feel free to reach out to Muslim Wellness Foundation Atlanta. And JazakAllah khair for all the work you do.
Thank you, Zahra. There was one comment over here.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I just moved from, you know, Buffalo, New York to over here. You know, my two kids was in, in madrasa. They are doing, you know, a recitation of Quran, Holy Quran. And I put them on either public school and I asked them, you know, to give, you know, a Friday prayer leave, and they refused. And I'm so upset. So please, if you can do something, you know, for Friday prayer, you know, leave for the, you know, student, high school student, it will be much, much, you know, better. JazakAllah khair.
So CARE, obviously, we're a civil rights organization, so if you have an issue, any issue with being mistreated at school, at your employment, dealing with government offices, just let us know. You can contact, if you have a harassment issue, again, the email address to use is speakup@cairga.com, speakup@cairga.com, or you can contact me directly, and what I'll do is I'll collect all of your email addresses now, and I'll send you a message after this so you have my contact information, inshallah, and I'll share that with all of you as well, inshallah. If you have your cell phones, take out your phones now, inshallah, if you got your phones.
So, inshallah. So, Bismillah, so your son getting Juma off is very important. And it's been done here in Georgia. You're from Buffalo. We've done it many times by getting a letter written from your masjid, from your imam, taking to the school principal. This is an in-house decision that has to be made from your principal. And you do it with grace and an understanding that they're not familiar with the religion of Al-Islam, and you explain how your son would not do what they're responsible for, and it wouldn't interfere with his education. So create a small plan that you feel makes sense and begin that negotiation process with your principal. But bring supporting documents about your religion, about your religious practice from your imam, from your masjid, full leatherhead in the nine, to make sure that they have a better sense of you not being alone and by yourself. If there's other Muslim students there in the school, allow them to sign on as well. And that will assist you in moving the process much quicker. It's an in-house type of dynamic. You don't want to try to go over their head or anything like that. You just want to deal strictly with the decision maker.
And I can't tell you how many times I've gotten a complaint of discrimination or harassment, and all we have to do is send a letter, make a phone call, and they come to their senses very quickly. So let us know. Don't just let it roll off your back. All right, everyone's got their phone now? Yeah. All right, you're gonna text message your email address, just your email address, to the phone number I'm about to give you. If you've done this with me before, don't do it again. I've already got your information. But if you haven't done it before, you're going to text message only your email address to the phone number I'm about to give you, and then it'll populate, and we'll have it in the list, and then we can share it among ourselves. The phone number is 678-586-0963. Again, the phone number you're going to text message your email address to is 678-586-0963. One more time, the number is 678-586-0963. Text message your email address, then you should automatically get a reply back. You might not get signal down here, so if you don't get signal, just do it when you get up to the upper level, inshallah. Anyone other comments or questions before we...
Imam Shabri, he's mentioned a couple of really cool events coming up that you're planning.
Iman, I-M-A-N, Atlanta, on Facebook.
Okay, and you can also go to AtlantaMuslim.com.
Excuse me?
If we just like it, we'll get all this information.
Yes, ma'am. That's correct. So you like the page and visit it often. You'll get all the details. And we post. So they're...
The website.
Yeah. You can also go to AtlantaMuslim.com. All organizations should post our events on Atlanta Muslim, because when you look to the right, you'll just see a schedule of what's happening that week.
No, Aisha, you asked us to each give an action item for the room. I just hope that every family represented in this room will commit one person to... take one of the actions we've talked about here. And we've given you a lot of ideas, and they've ranged from talking to your neighbors, engaging in interfaith work, going to city council and county commission meetings, and calling your elected representatives in Washington. And I hope everyone can just have one person in their family starting to participate in things. That's my tip.
So I already gave two homework assignments, so I won't give a third. But the one thing is, if you do have questions about school, you can go to isbatlanta.org. That's a resource where if you want interfaith session done in your community with local churches, synagogues, or even to your schools or clinics or hospitals, just go to isbatlanta.org and you can see what presentations there are and ask for a request that someone come out.
Embrace your faith. Don't turn away from your faith. Go harder into your faith, stronger into your faith, and know that Allah will protect you. One, as you protect yourself, work for yourself, and two, utilize all of your rights as a citizen of this country. All of the rights that are due to anybody who lives in this country, utilize them for yourself, inshallah.
Can I say one thing I didn't get a chance to say before? Sorry, I just wanted to be able to explain one more thing about DC because it's a near-term action item. I can't emphasize enough how powerful the political appointment process is, the Senate confirmation process is. The agencies in Washington cannot, they are very limited in their ability to make new policy, to change existing policy, if they don't have assistant secretaries, undersecretaries, and cabinet secretaries approved. Then it's all career staff running the agency, and a new administration cannot run the procedures they need to run to change policy. So the extent that people take action to slow down and limit the speed at which appointments get filled in the new administration is a powerful way to slow things down from happening to all the communities and issues we care about, especially if people are trying to organize for the 2018 midterm elections and trying to make sure that new people come into Washington and can limit the damage that is done in the next 2 years. On the appointments process, it's not a strict process. So it can at any moment they will nominate people, then they have to go through a Senate confirmation process. The timeline for how long that will take will be governed by each of the Senate committees themselves. If people are, they have to file a lot of documentation, like unlike our president-elect, they actually have to file financial disclosures, and a lot of disclosures have to get filed, and then there'll be public hearings about that person. They'll have to sit and hear questions from their from the senators, and then there'll be a vote from that point. So there are a few steps in the process, so it can't happen that quickly.
So action item, dig deeper in your pockets and give towards the organizations that have committed themselves to working for our community. I think that this is a critical time for us to double down on how we invest in the work that those who are on this panel are doing, but also in areas that we know that nonprofit organizations in particular who are struggling to support social work as well. The second thing is, practice your sunnah, your Second Amendment sunnah. Learn how to shoot a bow and arrow, the modern day one. And I think that's what's coming up next. So, alhamdulillah.
That's quite a sight.
Thank you to all of our panelists. Can we get a round of applause? All right, so we are going to transition into our self-defense portion, and I will hand that over to Brother Edward.